Yep, we are live and direct. Well, we are direct and live, whichever one you want to choose, you know?
Exactly. And listen, I kind of mentioned this before, but listen, people who are watching this on the YouTube, check out Mr. Duval's t-shirt, which is, he's rocking some great t-shirt, man. This is like, it's you know what? It's a statement.
It's a statement.
Hang on a second.
It is a statement.
Exactly.
You got to put your fancy lights on. Well, yeah, I mean, it's Black History Month here in the UK. I know some people are for it, some people are against it and stuff. You know, people say it should be, history of different cultures should be included in just normal, you know, history, which, you know, they're right.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just thought, oh, you know, honor the month, wear a little t-shirt.
Exactly.
Because in the UK, this used to be a sign. It used to say, no blacks, no dogs, no Irish.
No Irish.
But I'm saying more.
it's wicked, man. It's powerful. It's really, really good. Whoever came up with that t-shirt, man, it's really, really good. It's a good seller. So listen, look, folks, we are the Flixters, Deval and I. We've been doing this a while now. So this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna be doing shout outs, movie news, streaming, trailers, film reviews.
Yep.
And hope you enjoy it. Join us on Instagram, join us on YouTube, check us out, watch our faces. And if you like what you hear and what you see, then please comment, like, subscribe, do all that sort of stuff. We will appreciate it.
Yep.
So Deval, as always, take it away, man.
Yeah, first shout out goes to king.selani, and she's on Instagram. Really great profile, go check her out. She's she actually does quite a lot. Music videos, she's an artist, a model as well. So really, 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 really great page, and also really always always interacts with us as well when it comes to movies, telling us what she wants to see and what she thinks. She's actually going to go see Smile. So we put out a post to do with Smile, the horror movie we saw last week, and she's now going to go and see it. She loves a good horror, and many people don't. So it's good to see when people do like a horror. So yeah, go see that king.selani. Second shout out goes to cloudwatcher.uno. Again, he's a music guy. He's actually got a music event happening this very month of October. So go check out his page, cloudwatcher.uno. Go check out his page, buy tickets to his event. And I'm going myself. So if you do go in London, you'll see me there too.
And you know what, on his Instagram page, man, he's just like, it's every kind of like week, I always see like, there's a different event going. Every
home, he's always going out.
He doesn't stop, man.
He gets up close and personal, takes really good pictures of the events as well.
Definitely. All right, don't miss it. If you're in the neighborhood, please do check it out. All right, okay. So thanks for that. And remember, folks, you can follow us on Instagram. Keep a lot with us, and we'll take you to places you haven't been before. Ooh. Movie news, Devaldo. Now, this one. Oh my gosh. Now, first of all, tell me, when was the last time we saw a Sister Act movie hit the screens? When was it?
Sister Act. You know what? I want to say it was 1992. No.
It's got to be after Ghost.
Sister Act 2, Back in the Habit. 1993, it was. 1993, it had Lauryn Hill, it had obviously Whoopi Goldberg as the main sister. Lauryn Hill, Sister Act 2 was a really, really good film. It's one of those almost perfect films. Do you know who it's directed by? It's directed by Bill Duke, who we saw in Predator. Yeah.
Oh my God, Bill Duke.
Mac, I'm going to have me some fun. I'm going to have some fun. Him. He directed Sister Act 2. So he, you know, I reckon he said at the start of the film in Sister Act 2, we're going to have some fun. But that's not the news is, sorry, I'm going on a tangent. Sister Act 3 is going to happen. So Whoopi Goldberg's going to be back. We're going to have Bette Midler back as well. We're not back, she's going to be in it. Also, Kiki Palmer is going to be one of the sisters, I think. She's going to be in it. How she's going to be in it, I'm not sure. But you know what? If they can make it to have the same feeling as Sister Act 2, onto a winner.
Yeah.
I doubt it, but we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, but why do you think it's taken Whoopi so long, man? Because that was, she's known for, like, Sister Act is one of the movies that she's known for, that and, like, Ghost and everything. Yeah. So you'd have thought maybe, like, 10 years ago they would have done something, or 5 years
maybe
ago.
Maybe she didn't want to do it. Maybe the script wasn't right. Maybe she was busy because she does this TV show TV. In America and stuff like that. She does other stuff as well. But, yeah, you never know. You never know. Maybe the money wasn't right. Mm. I do not know. But it's going to happen now. So we'll get that in the next couple of years.
Exactly, and it's going to come on Disney Plus, so it'll be on the streaming platform.
Yeah.
So if whether or not they'll do a whole cinema release, you know what? It's so funny. Since we've had the streaming wars, Deval, like you know these streaming players, it almost feels like as if the movie's not a big budget, $200 million movie, is like, you know what? You're going to find it on streaming service somewhere.
Yeah. It's just how it's like hard to justify, or not justify, to measure the success totally with, I guess you get it with the clicks and streams, but in the box office is money that you can really count, isn't it?
Exactly. But listen, folks, we will obviously keep you posted on any of that sort of news. Now let's move on to kind of some Marvel news. So I'm not sure if this popped up on your radar, Devaldo, but Secret Wars apparently is now being delayed. And a lot of people are saying that this is welcome news because, so people are, and we've said this as well, not people are saying, we've said this, quality might have dipped a little bit with Marvel. And is that because they're churning out so many kind of programs and, like, you know, movies, and maybe it's too much for Kevin Feige to juggle now?
Yes.
Maybe somewhere along the line, he's going to drop that ball somewhere and a few little turkeys are going to kind of pass through. So this is, I mean, in a way, I hope this is a good news because it gives them time to focus on the story, the characters, the actors, the action, and making this movie right, because Secret Wars is going to be huge, man.
Yeah.
This is a big thing. It's a big thing.
So what's it now? 2025, I think it is now. I think.
Yeah.
Directed by Michael Waldron, who's come through from Rick and Morty, who understands about multiverse and stuff like that. He was involved in Loki. So, yeah, I mean, you know what? I'd rather they take their time and get it right. You know, season it right.
Yeah.
Slow cook it. Don't rush it. Slow cook it. You know, them slow cookers where you can put it on in the morning. You can go to work, come back, and then you can eat. Slow cook it like that.
One of them ones, exactly. Because I think the fans will appreciate it as well if they've taken the time to kind of figure out, right, how does Ant-Man 3, how does the incursion stuff, and how does kind of the universes, the Nexus events and all that sort of stuff fit in with the Secret Wars and, you know, all these other new characters. So please, Marvel, I know you're listening. To take it easy, like, slow down and, like, you know, remember it's quality, not quantity. All right, let's move on a little bit. So Deval, Bad Bunny, you know who that is, right? You know who Bad Bunny is.
Bugs Bunny's evil twin, or I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
I was waiting for you to say something funny. Bad Bunny, he's like a musician. He's like a Latino musician, but he also appeared in Bullet Train just recently with Brad Pitt.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
All right. So he's like transitioning. He's going to be another person who's like going to become like a full blown actor now. This is it. Like, you know, they start off like, you know, one career and then, you know, they end up doing this. So check this out. So Bad Bunny, the rumor is that Bad Bunny is going to star in an El Muerto movie from the Sony Marvel universe. So, you know, like how we've got Kraven the Hunter, we've got Morbius, Venom, which we, you know, there's going to be a part three. Yeah. They're going to be adding now a character called El Muerto. Ah. And, you know, he's basically death. And so check this out. Jonas Gauron. Duval Gauron. Who's Gauron?
I don't know. Should I know?
Alfonso Gauron's son.
Who's that?
Alfonso Gauron. Remember the great, the Mexican film director?
No.
No. Alfonso Cuarón. He's done loads of.
Is it?
He's done loads of movies.
I'm sure he has.
When I tell you the movies that he's done, right? Okay, here we go.
Probably seen his movies, but the name didn't ring a bell. Maybe it should ring a bell.
Okay, let me tell you.
It was a sign.
He's only. I mean, he's. Yeah. Let's have a look. Let's see what he's done. He's done Roma, Gravity, Children of Men, Y Tu Mama Tambien.
He's done Tambien with Gal
Pan's Labyrinth.
Bernal.
Pan's Labyrinth, man. So, yeah, exactly. So this guy, his son is taking on El Muerto for the Sony Marvel Universe. Okay. So I guess if he ever gets stuck, he's going to be like, hey, dad, can you just help me out with kind of like what's going on over here? But El Muerto, I'll be reading up on El Muerto, and he's an interesting character, Divaldo. So a lot of kind of, you know, the, I think there was there a movie already about this? But basically...
probably an anti-hero as well, probably, isn't it?
Yeah, kind of like an anti-hero. He kind of summons up kind of like, you know, the dead. You know, he has the power of the dead as well.
Muerto
kind
means of death in Spanish, doesn't it?
Exactly, exactly. I mean, you know, you're a Spanish speaker, so course, you know. All this stuff. But listen, it's interesting because Sony are still going ahead, even though they've churned out two turkeys in Venom and Morbius. They're still going ahead with their, like, you know, man. It's like...
Oh my gosh! Sony want money, man. Sony make money. They don't care about reputation. Reputation means nothing. They want to count the do, re, mi.
Me, exactly. So El Muerto is going to be the first Marvel movie to start a Latino character, as well as Bad Bunny's first time leading his own movie. He's a Grammy Award winning rapper. He's been in F9. I didn't even know this. He was in F9. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that. No. Okay, he's doing his thing, yeah? Okay.
He's doing his thing, and he's going to be representing the Latinos, you know, around the world and everything. So we'll check that out. I'm not holding my breath in this one, do I?
No.
It's a Sony Universe movie. So listen, folks, we're going to move on to streaming, and we're getting towards the end of Aldo. Now, we were kind of talking about this. This was going to happen at some point. We were going to end up seeing Daredevil.
Yeah.
In She-Hulk, he does appear, and you know what? I don't know if I'm liking it because they've joked it up.
I knew they were going to do this. Yeah, I mean, it was a better
episode. Joked him up
episode, but
it was a better episode. Just,
yeah, Daredevil's going to be a joker. They're all going to be jokers, aren't they? So, yeah.
I mean, Daredevil, he's like that scene at the end where he's walking off and like, you know, he's just walking down the street. I mean, come on, man. You R-rated Daredevil would never have done that.
No. But this is the he has to fit the tone of the show he's in. So now it's a bit of a joke, and yeah, it's just, I mean, it's like I say, it was entertaining. It was not a bad episode. He made it better for me. The episode was better because of him.
Yeah, he did.
But I don't know, man.
And did you notice they try to keep a bit of the tone of that? Like, you know, the fighting in the corridor, like making it dark and everything. And like, you know, so that was all good. And I was like, yeah, this is great. I can't wait. But I mean, we're just going to have to wait and see whether or not his Daredevil, his own show, is going to be anything like obviously what we've known before. But what did you make of the episode overall, though?
Overall, like I said, it was okay. It was better than the previous episode. So it was, I watched it a bit more entertained and a bit more happy. Overall, I think the fighting was cool. The interaction between them was all right. She got it on. She got a leg over. And the fourth wall break was funny as well. Towards the end, that was kind of funny.
Towards the end, right? And she mentioned Red Hulk.
Exactly. Yeah. Which I think I reckon they've taken her blood for the Thunderbolts and to make the Red Hulk probably.
Yeah.
But I think it'd be interesting to see who the real actual villain is and how they reveal themselves in the last episode. So I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, she has a bit of a rage. She has a bit of rage issues at the end. So that was good to kind of see. So we'll see how that pans out. So listen, last episode is coming up next week.
Yeah,
and we'll be speaking about it on the show next week. So let's move on to House of the Dragon and Devel. I mean, I saw the episode on Monday or whenever it was that it came out, and you know what? I've forgotten half the shit that went on in the episode
because
we're recording this on Sunday.
Yeah, it was a lot. It was a lot. I mean,
it was a lot, right? There was a lot of shit to get through.
Yeah, this episode really looked at the way the feud between Alicent Hightower and Rhaenyra Hightower. The kids are involved as well. This, I don't know if I sent you a thing. You can find on YouTube a lot of the lore, the histories of Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
And in these histories, they're like animated audiobooks. Really interesting. And in these histories, they talk about what we're seeing. Because is it Aegon who cut his eye?
Yeah.
In the
that punch up was
exactly
good.
In the books. He has a ruby. He puts a ruby in his eye, and he's really like a fierce person. He gets on that dragon. Is it Vhagar, the big dragon?
Vhagar.
He's the
biggest dragon.
He's an angry boy, and all the kids as they grow up, you kind of see how they develop, and the feud. This is the start of the feud. This is the start of the Dance of the Dragon. The Dance of the Dragons is the downfall of the Targaryens, and we're seeing it play out. So it's interesting to see how we saw in season one of Game of Thrones, the things that started everything, you know, and we're seeing it happen now. So pay attention. It's good. It's getting good.
Yeah. And you know, the thing is, he now kind of became the rider of the dragon, Vhagar, and everything. So that one dragon, and his granddad, like, you know, the Hand of the King, he says that eye, like the dragon is worth more than his eye, basically. Yeah.
He said, I lost an eye, but gained a dragon. It's fear.
Yeah.
It was like, that just shows you he's gangster. From that young age, he's going to be dangerous. Trust me.
And what a dragon this is going to turn out to be. So basically, just exactly like what you said, you see the kind of the war line is they're being drawn. Mm. Like, you know, you can see them on this side, and you know, what's his name? Morbius, not Morbius, the guy who was in Morbius, Matt Smith.
That's his character, Damon Targaryen.
Damon Targaryen, he's on that side. They get married, and obviously this kind of keeping it within the family. So I can't wait to see how this all plays out. So we've got like four or five more episodes.
Actually, 10. Right? I said 11 last week, but I made a mistake. So there's 10 episodes. I think there's two left.
Two left.
So two left, or three. One of them. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And we're going to get another season, right?
Of course. Definitely. Definitely. Yeah.
I mean, this is HBO, man. This is HBO. Andor. Let's move on to Andor again, Deval. I'm missing it with the Andors, man.
You've not seen it?
So tell me what's going on. No, I didn't watch it. I didn't watch the latest episode.
Diego Luna. He's doing all right, though. What I like about this is Rogue One in pieces. It's just bit by bit. It's very slow. It's very deliberate in how they show you different parts of the story, different characters. Everyone's got their own personality. It's very political. There's no magic. There's no Jedis. There's no big, you know, bad. This shows you about the rebels against the Empire, and how the different pockets of rebels are trying to... They are literally infiltrating the Empire, and it takes a lot of work to do it. A lot of work goes behind. The way they train, how to walk like troopers, like Star Troopers, because they're going to try and infiltrate them and get behind the scenes. Yeah. So all these little intricate things are planned really well. And this goes to show... This show really shows how that happens and how there's mistrust, even within the rebels, because sometimes it can be people that are, you know, double agents. So there's lots of mistrust, and people are, do you know what? It's a decent show. It's not going to blow you away, but it's a decent show. It's one of the better Star Wars shows that they've got at the moment. Yeah. So when you've got your time, do watch it. You will like it.
Yeah.
You will like it.
Yeah, yeah. You know what? It's been a busy week, and I was like, look, there's a couple of things that I'm going to watch, and I was meant to put that on the, you know, watch it this week, but time just slipped me by. But yeah, I'm definitely going to catch up on that one. So that's Andor. And listen, look, folks, this is kind of, I did have time for this because this was very intriguing to me, and this was kind of like interesting. So this is Werewolf by Night.
Yep.
And this is kind of like a one-off special, a holiday season special, which I think from the response that Marvel have got, they are going to kind of do more of these.
Is it?
But listen, I just got to say one thing. Tonally, Deval, tonally, this is unlike anything that Marvel have put out.
Yeah.
Number one, it's got like violence in this. Mm-hmm. It's got like, I wouldn't say kind of like, you know, bad language, but there are kind of like a few words like where you would like, you wouldn't hear that in a Marvel TV show or in a Marvel movie. Mm-mm. And it's got a really offbeat type of a kind of Frankenstein, like horror-y vibe going along with it, which I totally dug. I totally dug this, man. It's about 50 minutes. It stars Gael Bernal Garcia.
Yep.
You know, we spoke about
Mama Tambien.
Y tu Mama Tambien. So there's kind of that connection over there. And Deval, I've been doing some research. You know the his buddy in this, the kind of that tree thing, the swamp thing.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, go on, tell me.
He is a gangster. He is going to play. I watched, I didn't know this. I came across an interview that Kevin Feige basically gave, and he says this werewolf by night is going to be so important to the rest of the MCU. He goes, watch this space, because that thing, he is a guardian of the nexus of all realities.
Is it?
In the comic books. Now, they're saying that basically this leads on to Secret Wars and all the other kind of incursion stuff from a Multiverse of Madness and stuff. So what I think is Kevin Feige is dropping these little pieces, but they're also going to fit into kind of this wider thing of the Secret Wars and kind of the incursions and stuff like that. But listen, if you read his backstory, Ted, I think his name is Ted Ellis. He takes a version of the Captain America super soldier serum. Mm. He gets infused with a thing that's living in the swamp. Mm. And then he becomes the nexus. He becomes the guardian of the nexus of all realities. And that thing allows him to basically go to different realities, even beyond the sacred timeline. Mm. It's mad. Because he controls it.
Because towards the end of it, I mean, it was black and white for most of it, and then it went to colour when they were towards the end. So I don't know if maybe they did cross over to another multiverse or something. I don't know. But yeah, it was an interesting one. It was very, very much back in the days of like the old school horror from the 30s, like, you know, the Dracula,
the Dracula, the Wolfman. Yeah,
exactly. So it kind of, you know, it was like a love letter to that sort of age of horror film, which some people won't really get, but, you know, real cinephiles, you know, they'll really like understand us, it. Val, exactly. Like, so it was something different, like you say. Sometimes a little difference is a good thing, but yeah, I think it was cool and I enjoyed it. So yeah, I'm looking forward to a bit more of that. Wouldn't complain.
I think we're going to get, I can't remember if you said it or maybe Emmanuel who said it, but we're going to get a Guardians holiday special as well.
Yeah,
aren't we?
I'm not sure how it's going to be, but yeah, it's going to be a Guardians. I think it's December or something like that. And also just to mention the director, Michael Giancia,
the composer.
Yeah, he's a composer. That's what he does. And he directed this episode of Werewolf by Night. So interesting.
Crazy. Crazy. So listen, go check it out, Werewolf by Night, and watch this space, because, you know, I think, you know, it is going to lead on to other little stuff. It's all going to be connected. All right. Okay. Let's do new trailers. And we got one here. If you're, you know, if you're feeling a bit peckish, check this out. The Feast, Deval.
This is a movie you need to watch. This trailer, this is a Welsh movie. So we're getting international, yeah?
Oh.
Welsh. This is a Welsh horror film. This is about a young woman who's serving some privileged guests in this remote house. It's like a special dinner that happens. And it's kind of like a mixture between war, Midsommar. It's just weird. Let's just say, like, you know, lamb chops. I know there's sheep in Wales, but it's not just going to be lamb chops on the menu. Do you know what I mean? or Welsh rare bits, or whatever they eat. Something else on the menu. The trailer looks weird, man. Thing is, it's in Welsh. It's not in English, so it's got English subtitles, Welsh dialogue, different. Go watch it. This is out now. You can actually watch this now somehow on download. It's worth it.
Oh, man.
I'm gonna say it's the Feast.
Yeah,
2021.
The Feast.
Yeah, hour and a half long.
I love these kind of like weird little quirky movies that you don't expect, and you know, you get surprised by it all. So listen, go check that out, The Feast. And if you do see the trailer, please do let us know. All right, let's get into Anniversary Corner, Devaldo. Now, this one from 10 years ago.
Yep.
2012. This is Red Tails. Now, this is based on a true story, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. So this was a crew of African-American pilots in the that were involved in the Tuskegee. You know that program in America where they took lots of African Americans and they put chemicals,
Tuskegee.
They put things in them to test it. Yeah, so
so
this happened during that time period, and the Red Tails were like a group of African American pilots who were just gangster pilots, and they were fighting in the wars. Obviously, a lot of their story wasn't really told, and this film really, you know, tells that story. It's Black History Month in the UK. I know in America it's in February, but here in the UK it's now. So I think it's important that, you know, we definitely talk about. Talk about all kinds of films all throughout the year. So here at the Flixters, we don't really concentrate on one month, but we just felt, you know, it's important just to put one out at least, you know.
Yeah.
But
and this is George Lucas.
Yeah, George Lucas produced, directed by Anthony Hemingway, a brother, Cuba Gooding Jr., David Oyelowo. It's got Terrence Howard in it. It's got Neo's in it. Yeah, Nate Parker. It's got a whole bunch of brothers: Michael B. Jordan, Melvin Odom Jr., who's going to be in The Exorcist soon. Method Man.
Yes,
cow. It's got Bryan Cranston in it. You know, it's got everybody in this film.
Oh my gosh!
So yeah, great film. Go watch it. 10 years old, but it doesn't feel like it. So go watch Red Tails. No. Go watch Red Tails.
Yeah, and I think you can catch it on. This will be on Disney, won't it?
This is on Disney Plus. Yeah, exactly.
So you don't even have to go anywhere to get it. It's right there. All right, okay, let's do film reviews now. We've got a selection of movies which we hope you know, you can go out and watch, because some of them are these are going to be kind of like really great to see. But listen, the first one is The Woman King. Now, unfortunately, this movie hasn't come out in Australia yet, and it's coming out towards the end of the month. So Deval, he went out and watched this. So The Woman King, Deval, and it's only befitting that this movie is coming out now, because it celebrates, you know, stories from, you know, from Black history.
Yeah, exactly. So this is, just like you said, this is The Woman King, starring Viola Davis. Also starring South African actress Tuso Mbedu. You've got Lashana Lynch, who we saw in Bond, who we've seen in the MCU. It's got Sheila Atim, who was also in Doctor Strange, Multiverse of Madness, had a small part in that, but she's also been in lots of other movies and shows as well. She was in Bruised, she's in Pinocchio. Bunch of other stuff as well. We also have John Boyega playing the king, King Gezo. So this is The Woman King is of the Dahomey people, who in modern day Benin, just next to Nigeria.
Right.
And this tells the story of their kingdom and the relationship they had with not just, you know, themselves and their people, but with other kingdoms in neighboring parts of Africa. This was in the 18th and 19th centuries, when the slave trade was still happening in Africa. So what a lot of people understand, obviously, is Europeans came to Africa, took people, and it's important to say took people and sold them into slavery. A lot of the times it's said that they took slaves, when people didn't always start out that way. But there's also a lot of that is bad. You know, there's people actually being sold into slavery by other Africans, you know. So they were finding people and selling them to the Europeans as well. So there was lots of blood and lots of people's hands internally, obviously externally, massively, because that's where the trade was going. But there was division, you know. There was division in Africa, and I think this film actually talks about it, you know. And the Dahomey people were saying that, because they were involved in it. They were saying, we've got to stop doing this. Yeah. We can't be selling our people. We've got to sell other commodities like palm oil or this or that. We can't be selling our people. That does get discussed. But that's not the main thing about The Woman King. Is about, obviously, Viola Davis being the fierce leader that she is. They have a group of women who are the warriors of the Dahomey people. And it's a bit like the Dora Milaje. they kind of like are that in this respect.
Right.
They're fierce, they fight. There are men that fight with them as well, but they are their own kind of fighting force. And they go out, they battle, they kick ass. like Viola Davis and everyone, Lashana Lynch and the whole lot of them, they're really in good shape and they fight really, really well. So yeah, this movie is a historic depiction. Obviously, it's Hollywood, so they're also going to add some love in it and some drama and
exactly.
so on.
But
they do talk about a lot of things that have happened that, you know, people do know about and some people don't. So it's an interesting movie to watch. Overall, I mean, Viola Davis, whatever she's in, she's gangster. I can't really.
She's gangster.
I mean, we see her as Amanda Waller. We see her as Amanda, you know, Annalise Keating, and How to Get Away with Murder. The Help. Yeah. Whatever we see her, and she's gangster.
Great.
That's just how she is, and she is the Woman King. And there's the other actors around her, Tosu Mbedu, South African lady. She's gangster in this too. Lashana Lynch, she looks gangster. She's really built in this. And director Gina Prince Bythewood does a great job in, you know, illustrating these characters and showing them in their best light. So yeah, this is an all-round good movie. It's an all-round good movie. I must note, the writers of this is Dana Stevens and Maria Bello. Two white ladies, so surprised me. Yeah, it did surprise me, but you know,
look, produced by, I'm just having a look, I'm just going by the Wikipedia, it's produced by Viola Davis.
Yes.
Is it a thing now where Viola Davis, because she's got clout in Hollywood, she's a commanding person, I imagine, like off screen as well, where she's kind of said, listen, I want you to find me a script which is going to be like, you know, like this, which is going to showcase, female empowerment and maybe kind of like black writers aren't doing that. Or whereas, mind you, I'm pretty sure there are
I'm surprised. I mean, I'm not to say the writing wasn't good.
Knock these people.
Yeah, exactly. But it's just something that I thought with the ensemble that you've got, the black director, the black cast and all that. I just thought, you know, the people writing it should be like, it would have been best told from people that maybe understand it through the histories a lot better. But at the same time, I don't know behind the scenes, you know, what, why or when. It is what it is, but just something that surprised me a little bit. But either way, I mean, yeah, like I say, it's a good film. It wasn't as great as I thought it would be. I'm not going to lie. It wasn't as good. There were certain moments in it where I just felt it didn't really land. There was a little love part in it that was interesting, a little love part. And it kind of, you know, there was a bit of tension and conflict with these characters and how they can, you know, show their love or not, because certain things were frowned upon, you know. But John Boyega's character, he was the king, is the king, and he's, you know, he is a typical old school African king. He's got like 8 wives. And he's very, very, some of the things that he says and does, you know, today people will say it's misogynistic and stuff.
We're like, but back in those days, that's what it was.
Of when it was exactly. But yeah, it's an interesting, good film.
And does he have a big part? Is he kind of like a support?
It's not all about him. He is the king, but it's not all about him. It's called the Woman King, but end of the day, so he's got to, even though he is the main figure, it's not all about him. And he does it well. Yeah, he makes me laugh because he's Nigerian himself, so he does a good Nigerian accent, and puts
So Lashana and Viola Davis, do they do the accents
Nigerian
as well?
Nigerian accents, obviously theirs is not as good. Like John Boyega's is authentic. You can see he's around his uncles and aunties.
He's grown up around
his parents, I'm sure. Good film. Go watch it.
Yeah, man. When it comes out, I'm still going to watch it because look, we just spoke about Red Tails. A movie like that back in 2012, we thought, oh my God, we're not going to see a movie like that. And now 2022, we're seeing a movie like this, all mostly female actors, directed by, female African-American. Is she African-American as well?
Yeah.
You see, so, you know, obviously every decade there's going to be change and there's new stories coming out. So yeah, I'm going to check that one out. All right, Devaldo. So listen, we've got time for one more. Let's do Hellraiser.
Yeah, okay. Hellraiser. This is going to be quick, by the way. Hellraiser. 1987, Clive Barker original. And this one is a remake. Well, I actually don't know. There's been about 8 Hellraisers, you know. There's Hellraiser 1,
trust me.
Hellraiser 2, Hellbound, Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth. And there's all a list of them. Hellraiser in space. There's Hellraiser something. But this one.
Hellraiser in space.
Yeah, there is. There's a lot. But this one, yeah, this one's different. It's modern. It's set in 2022. And it follows the story of a lady who's got some alcohol substance abuse issues, and she's staying with her brother who's in a relationship with another man, and she's kind of seeing someone else as well. So basically her life is a bit not right. It's a bit of turmoil. And she comes across this cube while she's high. She activates the cube and she thinks she's seeing things, but really it's these demons, you know, that. And the Xenobites. Yeah, the Xenobites, yeah. So that teeth one's there. This film, so that's the story. So she comes across it, she unlocks it, and it sort of, you know, lingers around her. The thing about this, though, when you activate it, and there's about 6 different stages or 7 stages to the completion of the transformation of the cube. And each time you do it, a little prick comes out, and if it cuts you, it's going to kill you, basically. Right, so it kills different people, it cuts. And the way it kills, you know, these chains come out and get you, apart, and torment you. And
your
that.
Flesh.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll rip your flesh apart. That's what the guy said in part one. But so you see different people. Luckily, she doesn't get pricked by it. Her brother gets pricked first of all, and he dies. Different people get pricked, and it kills them in different ways. And this film is one of those films that the creatures look very artistic. It's like these sort of creatures would look great at a Halloween party. Like they just, art behind the flesh being open here or there.
Yeah.
It's like it's really precise. It's so artistic. It's almost beautiful in a really morbid way. It's crazy to say it. But the film in itself, it's 2 hours, you know, just under 2 hours. So I was a bit surprised.
Wow, that's a long one, right?
Yeah, it's following her around. It's just trying to convince people that there's something going on. And bit by bit, people do get convinced. It's not one of those ones that people don't believe her. They do get convinced after a while. And I don't know. I'm going around in circles because I just don't think it was a great film.
Or going around in cubes.
It just was. I wanted more from it. I wanted something different.
Yeah.
The lady Hellraiser. I mean, she didn't do anything bad or better than the previous, the pinhead, you know. Pinhead. And the other ones, they walk around a lot, and it's just, there's one that ran, and I was like, shit, they run now. One ran after her. And they got to this big house that this rich guy, originally years ago, this rich guy had the cube, and he loved it. He was like a proper artist, and he used the cube to kill people and stuff, and he went missing. And she realized that he had something to do with it. So she went to his house. It's got all these traps and trap doors, and it's a bit of a labyrinth, which is a good sort of location for where the film developed towards the end.
Yeah.
But the film just lacked. It wasn't even, I slept well.
It was lacking, yeah. I was going to say,
I slept well.
Sounds like it's
a preferred Smile the week before. That was good, original, something different.
Yeah.
Hellraiser is, you know what? I think Hellraiser now, it needs something like Freddy versus Jason. It needs another horror partner to merge with, because it was very lackluster. I'm struggling to even talk about anything that was really good about it. And I can't, I honestly can't find anything that was really good about it. I'm not going to lie.
It's so funny, right? Because obviously on the wiki page, it says the franchise was rebooted with an 11th film, which is what you saw.
Yeah.
And then check this out. It says, as well as a television series continuation in development at HBO.
There you go. And the director as well, the director, Daniel Bruckner, he done The Lighthouse. That was a good film. The Ritual. I really like that film. Southbound, another horror film that's good. VHS. So he's done some good horror films. I'm really surprised about this one. It's a letdown for me. It's a letdown.
Yeah. And then you know that thing where in the first one where he goes, I will eat your flesh. Yeah. Does she do anything like that?
No.
So by the end of the movies, is there a kind of like a bit of a truce between
them? She gets a choice.
Like in the original.
You can choose. Once you've configured it all, you get to choose about five or six things. Like you can choose Revelation. You can choose
a bloody genie.
Leviathan, where you can choose to bring someone back from the dead or something. And I think, I don't want to spoil what she chooses, but yeah, it's just the film, just a bit of a letdown, man. I can't really,
a
bit of a letdown. It's good it's on Hulu and not in the cinema. Cause
I still want to see it. Look, I know
see it
what
in your
exactly
own time
you've
got nothing else to see, man. Don't rush.
There's still an allure about it because I want to see what they did. Because I remember the movie from, 1987, watching it and feeling so kind of like, oh my God, this is like, nasty and everything. So I don't know. Yeah, I'll take my time with this one. So there's probably going to be more. There's going to be more Hellraiser stuff coming out. So folks, whether or not this has whet your appetite remains to be seen. So if you do watch Hellraiser on Hulu, and this is probably going to be for our North American listeners, let us know what you think. Does it live up to hype? So Deval, I think that's all we've got time for. We've got a nice round it off to a nice 40 minute episode for you.
Cool. Yeah. So next week we've got Halloween, and also I think you can talk about the fall next week as well, which you've been itching to
talk
about.
About fall.
And other bits and bobs. And the week after that, Black Adam. So it's going to be a good October.
Yes. And obviously add to that House of Dragon, She-Hulk and Andor and all that stuff. We'll be laying it down for you. All right. Okay. Thank you for joining us. And thank you, Deval, for doing this as well.
No probs. Peace out.
Don't forget to follow us on Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. Just pop in the Flixters podcast.